Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much to be here. Today, I have the pleasure to introduce PhD Amer. He comes from Lille Laboratory in Montpellier, France, and he will give the lecture, Adaptive Control of Small Tethered Autonomous Underwater Vehicle, on the frame of the 10th International Research Conference from the Polytechnic University of Tulancingo. Now, I will give a short biography of his professional career. Ahmed Chemori received his MNC and PhD degree both in automatic control for Polytechnic Institute of the North France in 2001 and 2005 respectively. During the year 2004 and 2005, he has been research and teaching assistant at Laboratoire de Signal System, LSS Central Supérieur at University of Paris 11. Then he joined Gisela former lab as a senior research postdoctoral researcher. He is currently a tenure research scientist in automatic control and robotics for the French National Center of Scientific Research, CNRS, at the Montpellier Laboratory of Computer Science, Robotics and Microelectronics, Lille. His research interests include nonlinear, adaptive and predictive control and their application in robotics, underactuated, parallel, underwater, humanoid and wearable robotics. He is the author of more than 95 scientific publications, including international journal, patent chapter, and international conference. He co-supervised 30 PhD theses, including 6 defended, and more than 35 NSC theses. He served as a TPC-IPC member of associate editor for different international conferences, and he organized different scientific events. In 2017, he had been visiting Huanzhong University of Science and Technology and China University of Petroleum as an invited professor. He has been invited plenary keynote speaker for various international conferences. Now, I give the microphone to PhD Amer.
Thank you very much for this introduction and good morning, everybody. So, let's start with the second lecture of today. And yesterday I talked about parallel kinematic manipulators, where I have introduced some control solutions and their real-time applications on different kind of these parallel robots, rigid or cable-driven and so on. So today we'll change slightly the subject. So we will stay in the subject of control, but the application will be changed. So today I will try to focus on underwater vehicles. I don't know if I should re-explain the beginning of the lecture, my lab and so on, or I can skip. It's another group, that's fine. So let me start by the presentation of my lab in Montpellier. So the lab is called LIRM and is situated in the south of Montpellier. So Montpellier is a very nice city and it's also a scientific city. We have different universities. So I have just to mention two things that characterize Montpellier. So the first thing is that the oldest faculty of medicine in Europe is situated in Montpellier. So it was founded around 1220. And the second thing, it's very attractive also, since Montpellier, it's on the, we have very nice beaches, we are in the south of France, we have a warm weather, and we have, at least, according to the statistics, more than 300 days of sun each year. Now, the lab is situated in the north of the city, and the lab has two institutions. So the first institution is the University of Montpellier, and the second one, it's the CNRS. So what is the CNRS? It's the biggest research institution in France, and it has many research labs in different cities and with all the topics of research, whatever the topic is, can be medicine, it can be electronics, mechanics, computer science, engineering, whatever. So all the labs, they include these research topics. So our lab has at least 440 persons, including so the permanent staff, the professors and the researchers, and also PhD students and the administrative staff. So, and the lab is organized in three departments. The first one is the computer science, The second one is robotics, and the third one is microelectronics. And I am in this department of robotics. And now I will say just a few words concerning the organization of this department of robotics. So we are approximately between 35 and 40 permanent staff, and we are organized in 5 research teams. So actually the organization of the department, it depends on the field of application of robotics or the research field. So we have 5 research teams. In the first one, we are interested in design and control of manipulator arms for 2 applications, mainly for industrial robotics and for medical robotics. The second one is IDH, and it's coming from interactive digital human. And within the research team, we are interested in humanoid robotics and interaction with human. And the third research team, we are interested in all what we concern image and interaction for manipulation of visual data. So the image processing, video processing, cryptography, and so on. The fourth research team, the researchers within this research team, they are interested in elderly persons and disabled persons, such that they will study the modeling control of the human sensory human sensory motor system, such that they design also neuroprotheses, and they apply this to help elderly persons and disabled persons. The last research team is called Explore, and it concerns mobile robotics in general, including so aerial vehicles, mobile robots, and underwater vehicles. So concerning me, I am physically in the research in the first research team called Dexter, but I work in collaboration with the other research teams. For instance, the presentation of today is a collaboration with this research team called Explore, since the subject is concerns underwater vehicles. Now, our lab is also well known by something which is very interesting, is the experimental aspects of the research. So it's not a theoretical research in robotics, but it's experimental with experimental applications. And we have a huge number of experimental platforms. I will just here summarize some of them. I will not detail them, but just to give you an overview. All these experimental setups are within this building inside. So we have parallel robots like that. Yesterday I talked about this subject. We have also cable-driven robots. So they are parallel robots, but they use cables. We have mobile robots, we have also manipulators. This is a classical robotic arm. We have surgical robotics, we have underactuated mechanical systems, we have humanoid robots, biped robots, and we have also underwater vehicles. So today, I will try to focus the presentation on this application. So I am interested in control of such vehicles. Now, just I will say a few words about my research field. So I made a PhD in automatic control, so from Grenoble. And actually, I continue working on control with different applications in robotics. So mainly here, as you can see, we have 4 or 5 applications. So the first application concerns underactuated mechanical systems. So I will give a lecture on this specific subject in forthcoming days. The second application is parallel kinematic manipulators, and as you can see, yesterday it was the lecture on this application. And another application, 2 together, so it concerns humanoid robotics for walking control and also wearable robotics. So the last lecture of this week, it will be on this subject, wearable robotics, exoskeletons. And the last application is the subject of today, it's marine robotics. So control of underwater vehicles. Nice. Now we arrive to the outline of the presentation. And here is the outline. So I will try to start with an introduction. I will try to introduce the context of control of underwater vehicles. But before that, I will try to focus on an explanation about underwater robotics. Why we design underwater vehicles? What are the research topics within this field of robotics? And also, I will try to talk about some applications, why we design these robots, for which application we design this kind of robots. Then the second point, I will focus on the formulation of the control problem, because it's not so easy to control an underwater vehicle. So we have some challenges, we have some problems, we have some things that we have to take into account. So we'll try through two examples to introduce the control problem formulation, and then we'll talk about the challenges. Then the third point, it will be the presentation of the experimental setup, so the different vehicles that we have in our lab on which I have worked on. And then I will just list also some proposed control solutions, and I will focus more on the experiments. And I will show two kinds of experiments. So the first test, it's in a swimming pool, in a controlled environment, so in the laboratory. And the last part, it concerns the experiments in real conditions. And you will see that this one, it's much more difficult than this one. Because in the lab, you can control, you have no waves, perhaps, you have no currents, you have no, the vision is very good and so on. But in the real conditions, the problem is more challenging. So I will try to show you some videos of this, and you can include the presentation. Nice. First of all, let's introduce the context.
The following is a production of good sound.
Could you increase the sound on the computer, please? On the computer. So I will show first video, just as a first kind of application. So this is an AUV. So it's an AUV designed in Woods Hole. Oceanic Institution USA, and they use this underwater vehicle. The application is to track and film and study sharks. So white sharks. Here they show the vehicle. It's equipped with 6 cameras, forward, up, down, left, right, left, and so on. And here, as you can see, is the application. So this is just to introduce the risk when you are working on an underwater control vehicles with an application of this kind. So to study this kind of population, so we have this risk, and as you can see, the attacks of the white shark of the vehicle. So this kind of vehicle used here, it's an AUV. I will introduce the kind of vehicles later on to give you a classification of the different vehicles. But actually, it's just to introduce the context. And here, as you can see, is the effect of this attack of the shark. Fine. Now, let me introduce other applications. So this is one of the applications that we can study. For instance, the fish or any sea animals, for instance, using underwater vehicles. Now, actually nowadays, underwater robotics is, or marine robotics in general, it's very developed, and we have a huge number of applications. I will just cite some of them. One of the applications, it can be, for instance, the inspection of some facilities. The inspection of dams, like this first application, so we can use an underwater vehicle to do this. Another application, for instance, is the fish farms. If you want to do a study in a fish farm, it's a good idea to use an underwater vehicle. And then we have another application which is very interesting also. It's the case for air crash investigation, so to look for the black boxes, so you have to use an underwater vehicle. And sometimes, or most of the time, one underwater vehicle is not enough, because if you have to cover a very large area, so you need many vehicles. And then you need to coordinate and control all these vehicles to look for these black boxes. Other applications we can find, for instance, in petroleum industry. We have here the case of pipeline inspection. Pipeline inspection, we use an underwater vehicle also. And many other applications like power stations, hydraulic power stations, offshore industry. We have also ship hull inspection and inspection of other facilities like bridges, like wind park. So for all these applications, the idea is to use an underwater vehicle to do this kind of tasks. Now, to be able to do these applications, we need to design or construct underwater vehicles. Now, let me give you just an overview of the existing marine vehicles. And as you will see, it's very easy to classify them. because there is a difference between one kind of vehicle and another. So actually here on this slide you can see the different kinds of underwater vehicles, and they will try to explain each one. And we have actually six kinds of underwater vehicles. So the first class of underwater vehicles, it's called ROVs. So ROVs is coming from remotely operated vehicles. And these kind of vehicles, so you have a tether, or you have a cable that relates the boat. On the boat you have the control system, and the underwater vehicle go, depend on the application, at perhaps 10 or 20 or 100 meters of depth. And the communication between the control system, the computer, where you have the operator, and the underwater vehicle, it is through the cable. And this cable, it's used to send the information in both sides. So from the boat to the underwater vehicle, so we send the control actions that are computed on the computer on the boat. And from the vehicle, we send to the boat the information that we have measured on the state of the vehicle. So the actual depth, the angles, the position, and the measurements coming from different sensors. So the cable is used to circulate the information for both sides. And this kind of vehicle, it's used for different applications, as we have seen before, the inspection applications, mainly they are made using this kind of vehicles. Now we have another class, which is also very interesting. It's the class of the crawlers. The crawlers are also like the ROVs, so they are manipulated or telemanipulated through this cable. And the difference between the ROVs and the crawlers, as you can see on the picture here, so the crawlers, they have wheels. So we can put them on the seafloor, so they can be on the seafloor, they are very stable, and they communicate through the cable. And these kind of vehicles mainly are used for manipulation. For instance, if you want to install a pipeline, you have to manipulate the pipeline to put it in the right position. So you use these kind of vehicles. So they are very stable because they are on the seafloor, so they are very stable. And then you can equip them with manipulators, with robotic arms, to manipulate, for instance, the pipelines. The third class is the class of the AUVs. And also, before I talk about the AUVs, the two first classes, we have no problem of energetic autonomy, since the power is coming from the boat, so we have no limit. However, the next class of the AUVs, and AUVs is coming from autonomous underwater vehicles. And for this kind of vehicles, we have no tether, no cable, no umbilical. So everything is embedded in the vehicle. So we have the actuators, the sensors, the control system, everything is embedded. So you send your robot, it goes to the desired position, for instance, it manipulates, it does something, then it goes back to the initial position, or you get it back in another position. And it is completely autonomous. So this is the idea of these AUVs. So it is completely autonomous, so we have two problems of autonomy. So we have the decision autonomy, so the robot is moving, how the robot will decide to move in one side or the other side, what will be the trajectory, the optimal trajectory, the planning of trajectory, and so on. And the second kind of autonomy is the energy, because everything is embedded and the robot is equipped with batteries. And the batteries, they are very limited in time. Using a battery, you can, for this kind of vehicles, you can do missions of few hours only. And then the battery is empty, and you have to get back the vehicle before the battery will be empty. Anyway, so this is the third class. Now the fourth class, it's the class called the gliders, like the air gliders. So here, as you can see, they have wings. And the gliders also, they are like AUVs, and they are autonomous. So everything is embedded, and they are very autonomous. How the class of the gliders works, you can see it on this video. Actually, the glider moves from the surface to the desired depth. Here it is in the surface, it goes to the desired depth, it takes some measurements, for instance, it goes back to the surface and it sends the information through the satellite to the operator here, which can be far away from the position of the vehicle. And we continue this motion. So from the service, we get to go design dev, we go back to the service and so on. And when we go back to the service, we can use the communication here through the satellite to send the information. Now, for this kind of vehicles, how it works, how it moves, it's slightly different from the AUVs. Since here, the idea is to optimize the energy used for the motion of the vehicle. And you know, with a vehicle like that, like the AUVs, so you have a mission of few hours. With a glider, you can make mission up to 6 months and even more. So you can send the vehicle and you can do a mission of 6 months. And how you can have this performance in energy, it's very easy. Here you have the vehicle. So to move the vehicle, you have to use two things. Inside you have a control of some masses that are inside the vehicle. So if you move these masses to the forward position, so the angle will turn like that. And you have just to push the robot to go to the desired depth. Then you take your measurements, then you move back the masses to the rear of the vehicle, it will be turned like that. You can use also the control of the buoyancy. The buoyancy is like a ball, inflate a ball or deflate a ball inside the vehicle, such that you change the buoyancy, and when you change the buoyancy, the robot can go to the surface automatically. It arrives to the surface, it sends the information, and you repeat the same cycle. So to control, you have just to give slight amount of energy to control so the buoyancy and these masses inside, that's all. However, for the AUVs, for instance, they use a propeller that is controlled through a motor. You control the speed of the motor to move the vehicle. So you need more energy, much more energy in the case of the AUVs than the gliders. Nice. Now, the next class is the class of bio-inspired underwater vehicles. And as the name indicates, so it's a bio-inspired from sea animals like fish, for instance, or turtles, or any sea animal. And the idea is to do bio-inspired, depending, it can be the morphology, for instance, it can be actuation system, it can be, we have different possibilities to design this kind of bio-inspired underwater vehicles. And the last class, it's the class of the ASVs, and ASVs is coming from autonomous service vehicles. So these kind of vehicles, they is like small boats like that, and they are controlled through the actuators that are on the vehicle. You can put, for instance, photovoltaic cells on the vehicle to get energy from the sun to recharge the batteries and so on. And we can use them for different applications. Nice. So actually, I give you just this overview of the classification of marine vehicles. Let me now talk about the main research topics in marine robotics. So we have different interesting research topics, and they are the following here. Maybe I have cited six, we can find more, but they are here the main research topics. So if you use an underwater vehicle, you design whatever the kind of the vehicle, you need to do the sensing. Sensing or the perception of the environment. You have to localize elements, you have to follow some moving elements, for instance. You have to see what is around the vehicle, the environment. So in this case, it's the case of sensing. And sensing, it means you choose a sensor. It can be a camera, it can be acoustic modem, it can be whatever the sensor. And then you decide how you will measure or you will do the perception of the environment. The second research topic, which is very interesting also, it's the simultaneous localization and mapping. The problem of localization is very, very important in underwater vehicles because, I explain why. For surface, for classical mobile robots on the Earth, you can use GPS to localize, for instance. You can communicate with different kind of support with the vehicle. You can give him the right position where the vehicle is and so on. However, for the underwater vehicles, it's very difficult to localize the vehicle. And mainly we use acoustics to do the localization with different kind of sensors, and it is a research topic in this area. Then we have also the problem of software. Since imagine that you have different kind of vehicles, you have the communication between vehicles, with the communication between the operator and the robot, the communication between different robots. So we need to design also a specific software to control these underwater vehicles. And the problem of communication also, it's a very hard problem to resolve, since most of the supports used on Earth, they don't work underwater. I give you an example. Here you use the Wi-Fi to communicate between two robots. Underwater, the Wi-Fi is not working. Or it can at least work for just a few meters, not more. So this one, this is why the communication is very important for underwater vehicles. Now, also, I give you another example, another research field which is very important. It's the swarm robotics, swarm underwater robotics. The idea is to use different vehicles, so many vehicles, and then to control and coordinate the mission of these vehicles to do the mission. So this is the idea, and this is also a research topic in marine robotics. And now the last one is concerning control. Control, so for sure, we design a vehicle, we choose the kind of the vehicle for the application and so on. We need to design a control algorithm to control the motions of the vehicle to realize the task in question. And for me, I am interested in this last topic concerning so control of underwater vehicles. Now, let me go further in this topic of control, and let's start with the control problem formulation to understand why it is interesting to be interested in control, and why it's very difficult to design controllers for these underwater vehicles, and what are the challenges related to this topic. And I will start with two examples. So here I will show you first video for a first application, and this application, it's called the ship hull inspection. So here you have an ROV, so remotely operated vehicle, and here it's the video from the camera on board the robot. So the feedback, the video feedback. And the second one, it's also another application where we use an underwater vehicle which is remotely operated by a human. So for both applications, what I have to notice here or to specify here is that the robot is controlled by a human through a joystick. So there is no controller, it's completely in open loop. As you can see here, you can see the operator, the feedback video coming from the robot, and the operator has two joysticks to control the robot. And from these two videos, what you can notice is the following. As you can see, the videos, they are not very stable. We have this problem of oscillation of the motion, so it's too hard to stabilize the motions of the vehicle if it is controlled by an operator in open loop way, using a joystick. So from these two applications that I have just shown you on these two videos, what we can notice is that this solution is very limited. Why it is very limited? Because of this problem of oscillations, lack of precision. You cannot position the robot with the precision in a place. So the robots continue moving this way because you have currents, disturbances, and so on. So it's too hard to have a good precision or high precision for this kind of applications. The vehicle is operated in open loop. What do we mean by open loop? Closed loop means that there is feedback. Here, there is no feedback because the operator uses a joystick to control the motions. Then the only feedback goes through the human. It's through the eyes of the human. You see on the video if the robot is moving or going up or down and so on. And this is not a real control feedback. It's through the human. Then also pay attention to two interesting points. So the first one is that manipulating an underwater vehicle through a joystick, it's very, very difficult. And this is because of the presence of currents, the buoyancy, the change of the parameter, and so on. So it's too hard to control a vehicle using using a joystick. And the last point, pay attention also, if you need an operator, an experienced operator, you have to pay. And it is mainly expensive, this operator. So to avoid all these problems, which are mentioned here, the best solution can be the automation. So the automation of this task, it means that we can remove completely the operator, so we have an autonomous underwater vehicle, Or we can do also, we remove partially the human. So we need the human for some parts, and for other parts, we need a microcontroller or a control system. So, however, the problem, if we adopt this solution, it's also not easy. Why? Because we need to design a sophisticated controller. So if you put classical PID controller, maybe it would not work perfectly. So, and we have to deal with some challenges like the nonlinear dynamics of the vehicle, which is highly nonlinear, the coupling between the degrees of freedom, the time varying parameters. If you take a vehicle, just a very simple example, you put the vehicle in a swimming pool, you put the same vehicle in the sea, you have not the same buoyancy because of the density of the salinity of the water. So this is one parameter that can be time varying depending on where you use your vehicle. We have strong uncertainties. We cannot know exactly and perfectly the parameters of your vehicle, like the inertia, for instance, damping and so on. And also, sometimes we have non-measurable states. And I give you a very simple example. Imagine that you put the vehicle in the swimming pool or in a real environment, in the water. How you can localize, how you can tell exactly the position of the vehicle in the environment. So we cannot, unless you have the vehicle on the surface and you have a GPS and a very good GPS, you can have a good positioning of the vehicle, measurement of this position. Otherwise, you cannot know exactly the position of the vehicle with precision. This is one of the problems. So now, let me continue emphasizing the challenges through this video. So during a mission, you have to design a controller to control the motions of the vehicle. The problem is, if you operate in real conditions like that, you can have the problem of underwater currents. This underwater current may disturb the robot, the vehicle, the cable, the umbilical. So we have to pay attention about this disturbance. Also, sometimes you need to install a new sensor. So you add a camera on board the vehicle, so you will modify the parameters of the vehicle, like the mass and the inertia. And you have to deal with this. Some other situations like that can modify the damping of the robot, so we have also to deal with this problem when we design the control algorithm. And now also we can have another problem, it's the interaction of the vehicle with the environment. We have to deal with this interaction, like the impacts. So we should design a controller able to reject these external disturbances. And to summarize these difficulties or these challenges, they are summarized here. The current that disturbs the vehicle, the modification of some parameters like the inertia or the mass or the damping, these two situations, and the external disturbances. So if you are interested in designing a controller, you have to pay attention about these problems. So you should design, in other words, you should design a controller that should be able to reject all these disturbances. So, in other words also, imagine that you want to modify the vehicle by adding a new sensor. You are not obliged to redesign a new controller. You should design just one controller that should work for all the situations. This is the idea. Because if you have to redesign each time a new controller to take into account the modification, this is not a problem, it's easy. But what is difficult is to design one controller that should be able to control the robot in all these situations, and you have nothing to modify. This is the idea. Nice. So in our case, we propose some solutions to do what we call the co-control. So you know the control, you do a feedback loop, or the control loop to control some degrees of freedom. Actually, we propose to do the co-control. It means that we choose some degrees of freedom, like here the pitch, the roll, the yaw, and the depth, 4 degrees of freedom that we can measure. So we have sensors in the vehicle. We can measure them, and we can control them through a microcontroller or control system. So we have to design a control for these degrees of freedom. And we propose that the 2 degrees of freedom that we cannot measure, which are X and Y, the position in the space, so this should be controlled by an operator. So if we combine a feedback controller with the human, so we call this the co-control. So the human controls some degrees of freedom, and the other degrees of freedom are controlled by the computer through the control algorithm that we should design. So this is what we propose to do in our case. Nice. Okay, now before I introduce the proposed control solutions and the videos of the experiment, I will show you some prototypes of underwater vehicles on which I have worked. And here, as you can see, they are four, they are five, in fact, I have added another one. So the first vehicle on which we start working is Akrov. The Akrov, it's a vehicle that you can buy. It's not very expensive, but the problem is the quality. So the quality of this vehicle is not so good, and especially the propellers. And a propeller in an underwater vehicle, you know, it's a motor that controls the rotation of this propeller. And depending on the speed of this motor, you can increase the force that will push the robot in one direction or in another one. So the robot is as it is like that. It can be manipulated through an operator using a joystick. But in our case, we try to modify the hardware of this robot such that we will control it through a computer and through a controller that we have to design. Actually, on the picture here, what we can see is the forces generated by the propellers. And the configuration of the propellers, the vehicle has six propellers, but the problem is that we can control only 5 degrees of freedom. The 6 degrees of freedom, we cannot control it. We see it through this picture, I explain. So an object in the space, it can have 6 degrees of freedom. So X, Y, Z, three displacement, linear displacement, and three rotations, rotation around X, around Y, and around Z. So 6 degrees of freedom. As you can see here, F1, F2, F3, and F4, they are in this plane. So through these four propellers, what we can control? So we can control this displacement, we can control this displacement, and we can control this angle. So X, Y, and the yaw angle, or the angle with respect to the Z axis. So 3 degrees of freedom can be controlled. And we have F5 and F6, two propellers that apply placed in the middle of the vehicle. And using these two propellers, we can control just the depth and the pitch. And this angle, it cannot be controlled. This is the wrong angle. Why? Because the propellers are placed in the middle of the vehicle. So we can control up to 5 degrees of freedom. And we have to pay attention to the roll angle. If it is stable, it's okay. But if it is unstable, we have to find a solution to control it. This is just the hardware of the vehicle and some technical parameters. 3 kilograms, so it's small, as you can see on the picture. 6 propellers, we control 5 degrees of freedom. And for the autonomy, we have no problem since the power is coming from outside of the robot. So we worked on this vehicle first, and then we designed another vehicle. So since the quality of the first one was not so good, so we tried at this time to design a new vehicle in our lab and to design it according to our needs. So we need to control the 6 degrees of freedom. And in this case, the idea was to change the orientation or the configuration of the actuators. I explain how we can control the 6 degrees of freedom in this configuration. As you can see here, we have 1, 2, 3 propellers, which are installed in this way, in vertical way, like that. So using this, you can control the depth, the pitch, and the roll, 3 degrees of freedom. Then we have 1, 2 propellers like that, so we can control X and the U. So we have 5 degrees of freedom. And the last one, it's here. It's a lateral one, so we can control Y. So using this configuration, we can control up to 6 degrees of freedom. Some technical details of this vehicle. So this is the size of the vehicle. It has 28 kilograms, the weight. We made some experiments up to 100 meters of depth, maximum depth. The autonomy is not a problem. We have 6 propellers, and we can control the 6 degrees of freedom of the vehicle. Now, we have another vehicle, and this vehicle is here in Mexico. So this vehicle is a vehicle designed at LAFMIA. It's a research lab, which is an international lab between CNRS in France and CIMVISTA in Mexico. This vehicle has 8 propellers, and there is a coupling between these propellers, and this vehicle is called LIRMIA 2, but they design different vehicles, LIRMIA 1, 2, 3, and so on. And here, this is some characteristics of the vehicle. So we can go up to 20 meters of maximum depth. And as you can see here, it has an autonomy of 2 hours. This is an AUV. So this is not an ROV, it's an AUV. So we can manipulate the vehicle up to 2 hours, 8 propellers, and we can control 5 degrees of freedom only. Then the next one, it's a vehicle, it's also an ROV, but the vehicle is slightly different. As you can see here, a picture from the patent. This vehicle was designed by Tecnalia. Tecnalia, it's a Spanish company. We have a collaboration with them. And we worked together on the control of this vehicle. So they designed and patented this vehicle. The specificity of the vehicle, it's its form. So it's omnidirectional. What do we mean by omnidirectional? The orientation of the propellers, as you can see here, they are oriented in 3 planes, which are perpendicular. Look, this one and this one, they are in this plane, this and this one, this plane, and this one, in this plane. And in this way, the vehicle is here, you want to go whatever direction you can. So it's a holonomic vehicle. Whatever direction you can move, this is what we call it omnidirectional. And this vehicle is also an ROV, you can go up to 100 meters of maximum depth, 13 kilograms is the weight, and it has 6 propellers. Nice, so till now, all the vehicles that I have presented, they use propellers. Propellers, this is a propeller. So you can use a motor that controls the speed of the propeller to control the force that will push the robot in this direction or this direction. Now, there is another idea. We can design robots that are actuated differently. I explain why. If you can see animals, like this example, they have no propellers. It's not a propeller. So they use the fish, for instance, or turtle or whatever. They use what? So they use fins. So we can, based on this, so we can create a bio-inspired vehicle which use also fins. And this was the origin of creation of this vehicle called UCAP. So UCAP, it's an underwater vehicle which is bio-inspired. And it was created at the Center for Biorobotics at the University of Tallinn in Estonia. So within this European research project, and we were not part of this project. So they start with the design, and then when they arrived to the control part, so they proposed us to work together on the control of this vehicle. So we start a research program or research project with them to control this vehicle. So before I go further, let me explain the actuation, because what I told you is we are bio-inspired, so we use fins. So the robot has 4 fins. The 4 fins are here. Now we want to control 1 degree of freedom. It's very easy. I want to move like that. I have just to orient the fins like that to do this motion of oscillation, and through one of these 2 parameters, either the frequency or either the amplitude, I can control the force that will push the robot in this direction. So you can choose either the frequency or the amplitude of the oscillation. So here you can see X, Z, and the 3 angles. So whatever the degree of freedom, we can control it separately and very easily, like it is illustrated here. But you know the problem, where is it situated? The problem, if you want to control 2 or 3 or 4 and so on at the same time, I want to control X and Y and Z and one of the angles at the same time. The question is how I will orient the fins and how I can control displacement of the robot through the control of the fins. And it's a very challenging control problem because it's not so easy to find the good orientation and the good force for all these directions at the same time. This is the problem. Now, I will give you just an interesting point also. You can ask me the question, but why do you use fins? You can use classical propellers and it's easy. So the origin of choosing the fins is coming from the application. So the idea is to do underwater archaeology. So we imagine that the robot will go inside a shipwreck and take some pictures and videos and goes back to the surface automatically. This is the idea. The fact that you will go inside the shipwreck like this one, you will be very close to the seafloor. And if you are very close to the seafloor and you use propellers, you will disturb the sediments. So if you use a camera, you don't see anything. This is the problem. But using fins, you will not disturb the sediments, or at least much more, you will have much more less disturbance to these sediments. Some technical features of the robots like the previous one, so it is designed for archaeology, for inspection, to identify objects of interest. It is small and highly maneuverable. You will see through the videos that it's highly maneuverable. Small, the size is very small, it's not big, it's this size, so it's small. To avoid to restrict the visibility near the bottom, so we have avoided to use propellers. And also, it is untethered, so it is an AUV. So it is an AUV, so it has everything embedded, and it has batteries, and also it has a limited autonomy. So it has four fins. We can control the 6 degrees of freedom separately. If you want to control all of them together, yes, we can try, but it's very, very challenging control problem. Now, let me just list some control solutions that we have designed for all these kind of vehicles. This is just an example of propeller, as you can see here. So we designed different controllers, and most of them, they are adaptive, and they can explain the idea why we use adaptive control. For instance, if you don't know the buoyancy of the robot, you can design a controller based on the estimation of this buoyancy. So you control the robot is moving, and in real time, you do an estimation of the buoyancy, and you use this in the controller design. And we have adaptive state feedback, L1 adaptive, we have rise control, sliding mode control, and different controllers. And we have applied these controllers to these vehicles. And now let me introduce the experimental results. And for the experimental results, I will start first for the experiments in the lab, so in a controlled environment, and then I will try to show you some experiments in real conditions. So the first experiment that we made here in this video, so the idea was to control just the depth, so 1 degree of freedom. In the vehicle, we have a sensor. The sensor is a pressure sensor. We can measure the depth, and we control the depth here. We designed an adaptive controller here, as you can see, a modified buoyancy through this ball. This is the nominal case, and we compare them. So if you can have exactly the same behavior in the two cases, you can say that your controller is robust. Here, as you can see, we can modify in real time the buoyancy, such that we can see that the robot goes away from the desired value of the depth, then it comes back around the value. So this shows also the performance of the controller to reject an external disturbance or an uncertainty coming from the modification of this buoyancy. Now we try to disturb the robot in another way. We try to push the robot with a small, a medium, a big, and a strong impact, and this is the result. So you can compare for the four cases. So the controller is able to reject these external disturbances. For sure, the last case takes more time, but for all the three first cases, it was very easy to reject this external disturbance. Another kind of external disturbance is the moving of the tether, and here, pay attention, as I said before, the vehicle is small, so it has this size. If you move the tether, you can very easily disturb it, because it's small. Here, it's another case where we introduce disturbances through the waves. We generate some waves here. The waves will disturb the umbilical, that will disturb the robot, and as you can see, the depth is very stable. And also, once again, here we can show that the controller is able to reject these external disturbances, and here by the end, you can see the comparison of the four cases where we try to disturb the robot through the uncertainties or external disturbances, and to show the robustness of the controller. Nice. Another video here in collaboration with LACMIA here in Mexico, and we are interested in a linear depth and yaw control. So here we control 2 degrees of freedom. This is the nominal case. We go from the surface to the desired depth. We control the angle of the yaw. So the desired value, we go from 30 to minus 30 degrees. As you can see, the robot is turning in a robotic way, so we have a reference trajectory to follow. And stay at depth 30, and we move to minus 30 degrees on the yaw angle. And this experiment was done in a swimming pool, as you can see. It's very stable, no external disturbances, and the life is very nice. But then I will show you some experiments in the real conditions, and we can see that it's much more difficult. And here we change, for instance, the depth 20, and we move from 30 to plus 30 degrees, so we turn the robot in this way. And here, as you can see, it's the tracking. The red is the reference, and the blue is the real one. Look here, we come from far away. We converge with any overshoot, without any overshoot, and it's very stable. Now we try to modify two things. So we add these two floaters to modify the buoyancy, and we add this sheet, as you can see here, to modify the damping. So we modify two parameters at the same time, but the idea now, we keep the same controller. We have not to modify anything on the controller. We modify the parameters of the robot, and we repeat the same scenario, introduce these two uncertainties, and we check if the result is good, if the control is robust. And as you can see, we repeat the same trajectories. We go to 30 centimeters of depth, minus 30 is the angle of the yaw. Then we stay at the depth 30, we move to plus 30, from plus 30 to minus 30 degrees on the yaw angle. And then we move to a depth of 20 centimeters. Here we change the depth, and then we change the angle of the yaw. As you can see, the robot is turning. We have slightly some oscillations, small oscillations, because of this big sheet that we have introduced to modify the damping. And this is the tracking. As you can see, slightly modified here and very precise, so the result is acceptable, and it shows that the controller, proposed controller, is robust. Let me show you now more results, and now the application is wall following or wall tracking. For this application, it can be the dam's inspection. So to do the inspection of the dam, you have to be at a certain distance, and you move using something like that. So you have to be near the wall, and you have to control the distance, and to control also the depth and the orientation. Actually, in this video, we used two cameras, so the stereo vision, to estimate the distance between the robot and the wall. And we have designed the controller where we control, so this distance automatically through a controller, we control the depth, we control the yaw angle, and you know, the operator has just to push the joystick like that, to move in this way. And it stays very stable in depth, yaw, and also distance between the robot and the wall. And this is the result, so we have used here a stereo vision based controller to estimate the depth between the robot and the wall. And it can help here the operator to do the dam inspection. Let me show now you the Meros robot from Tecnalia, this omnidirectional underwater vehicle. It's an ROV. And this vehicle, as you can see, it's moving. You can see the propellers, you can see the cable. And here it was also in a swimming pool. This is the swimming pool of the University of Montpellier. So we made the test in this swimming pool. Just actually for this video, there is no control. It's using the joystick and the operator. Unfortunately, I have not. I have results on automatic control of 4 degrees of freedom, but I have not video. So we made a controller to control 4 degrees of freedom. So the depth, the yaw, the roll, and the pitch at the same time to follow some reference trajectories. So we have some results using adaptive control in this case. As you can see here, the robot is equipped with a lighting system. So if you want to do an inspection, and so you have just to turn on this light and you can do the inspection. You can move, the advantage of this robot is that you can move in all the directions, so it's omnidirectional, and you can make your inspection in an easy way. You can even more also move through this inclined wall and so on. Now let me show you UCAT. So actually UCAT, as you can see, this is the first test in the swimming pool. You can see the 4 fins, you can see the control of the fins. We have just to control the orientation of the fins and the frequency of the oscillation or the amplitude of the oscillation. In our case, we have fixed the frequency and we control the amplitude. So the control input in our case is the amplitude of this oscillation of the fins to control the motion of the robot. And actually for this video also, we are controlling just 1 degree of freedom, which is the depth. So this was the first experiment in the swimming pool using a PID controller to control just the depth of the robot. Now let me go further to show you more challenging experiments or results. And in this case, I will show you some experiments in real conditions in the sea. Yes, so the first time where we have designed or tested our first controllers, it was here. It was at Banyuls-sur-Mer. It's very near to Spain, near the border between France and Spain. And we have this oceanography of the observatory, and they help us to make the experiments. And as you can see here, it's the first experiments in the sea. So near the harbor, as you can see the cable here relates to the control system. Actually here we control the depth and the yaw automatically. This is the feedback coming from the camera on board the robot. As you can see the visibility, so it's not so good because we are in real conditions. So here we have applied this concept of co-control. So the depth, the yaw are controlled automatically, and then the displacement X and Y are controlled by the user. And the second part of the video here, it's the ship hull inspection. So actually the operator has to move the robot until he will be very close to the ship hull. And this is the feedback from the camera on board the robot. So you can see the propeller of the boat. So we are very close. So if you want to do an inspection of the ship hull, you can use this controller or this vehicle. And as you can see here, you have the lighting system to help you to see clearly the environment here. But in any way, you can see the real conditions are different from the swimming pool, such that the vision is not so good. And actually here, we are not very, very, very close to the bottom. If you go close to the bottom, you can see more sediments. Now, let me show you another experimental result of UCAP. And actually here, it's not using a controller. It's the first time where they test the robot in real conditions, operated by an operator, using a joystick, and you will see something which is very important. Here, as you can see, the four fins that are in this initial position, so then we can start moving the fins, and the robot start moving. So this is the camera on the robot that gives us this view, and here you can see the motion of the fins. So it's swimming, it can change the direction quickly. You have just to change the direction, orientation of the fins. Here the Y control. So we can control separately all the degrees of freedom. As you can see here, it is turning, so we can turn also. So we can control easily the 6 degrees of freedom. It's not from separately, I mean. But if you want to control them together, it's difficult. Actually, one thing which is very important, as you can see here, the roll. It's not very stable. You know why? Because there is no coordination or synchronization between the two fins of the right and left. So it is doing this motion and it generates unstable motion or oscillations on the roll. And this is why, because it's controlled using the joystick and there is no synchronization between the two motions. Here, as you can see the fins, they are flexible. You can see also the roll, which is not very stable. And you can see the feedback coming from the camera on board the robot. So this was the first tests in 2015. Let me now show you another example. And in this case, we designed the controller. And you can see by yourself the difference between this one and the previous case. So actually, you push the robot. It's the deployment of the robot. We are very near to the rocks. So we push away the robots from the rocks. And then we start the controller. And in this video, we are controlling just 1 degree of freedom, it's the depth. We are close to the surface, you can see the working conditions. So the visibility is not so good as you can see from the video. And one thing also that I have to mention here, you can see this yellow wire. It's not an umbilical, it's just a wire to avoid losing the robot and also to disturb it. So we will use this wire to disturb, but there is no communication through this wire. It's not a cable, it's an AUV. So it's everything is embedded in the robots, the control system, the batteries, the actuator, sensors, and so on. So we go to the desired depth. When you arrive to the desired depth, the fins are oriented like that. Because if you want to go down, do this. Go up, do this. You arrive to the desired depth, you stay this. Now we pull the robot to the surface, and we release it, just to see what happens. And as you can see, the controller will control the robot to go back to the desired value of this depth, as you can see here. This is one thing. And one thing which is very important, as you can see, we are even very close to the bottom, but we are not disturbing the sediments. This is what I have explained before. It means that using these fins will not disturb the sediments. This is why we choose these fins to actuate this robot. Another experiment of UCAT also, and in this case, the idea was to follow another moving robot. The moving robot is an ROV, it's our robot, so it's controlled by the operator. But UCAT here, it's autonomous. So the idea is to follow it based only on one measurement, which is the vision. So we use the camera on board UCAT, we detect the position of the other ROV, and we try to follow it. And you know the most difficult thing here in this scenario, when the first robot is turning. So if it will be outside the field of vision of UCAT, you cannot do anything. So the idea is to follow it, but you have to avoid this problem when the robot is turning. And as you can see, look, it's turning, and UCAT automatically tries to turn quickly to avoid losing the first robot outside from the vision field of the camera. So this is a cooperation between two robots, between the ROV, the first one, which is Alturov, and UCAT. Now, I will show you another video, and in this video, the idea is to imagine a cooperation between UCAT and human. How we will do this? The robot UCAT is equipped with three hydrophones, and we will use a pinger. You know, a pinger, it's a small device like that, that will emit some acoustic sounds or acoustic waves. So the hydrophones on UCAT, they try to detect the position of this pinger. And then the robot will try to control himself to be oriented towards the pinger. If you move the pinger in the space, UCAT try to follow it. So this is the idea. So we ask the diver to put the pinger here, and to move. And UCAT, as you will see, it will follow the diver. So this was a scenario. As you can see, the diver is here, the pinger is here, the small yellow part, and here is UCAT. Look, the diver is moving, UCAT is controlling its heading angle, and it's turning towards the diver, and look, the diver is moving, and UCAT is following the diver. So this is a scenario just to show that it's possible to do cooperation between a human and a robot. Nice. And let me finish with the last video. The last video that we'll show you, it's the work of one of my former students. So when he finished his PhD, he created a startup. And the idea was to design and control a vehicle for cleaning up the coasts or the harbors. So Nicola is here. And this is the robot that he has designed. And as you can see, you will see how it works. It's very easily. Actually, the robot is controlled using the joystick, but the idea is to do an autonomous robot. So you put it, the idea is that you have a boat, you come with four or five robots, you put them in the water, and you push the button start, and they do the work. So they will move between the boats, and they try to gather or to clean up the waste. So gather this, as you can see here. Then you have just to remove this, and to replace it and to repeat the operation. So actually the startup is called IADIS, and as you can see here, what he has gathered in his case. So he has just to replace actually this net and to repeat the same operation. And he has designed this small vehicle because he needs small vehicle to be able to go in small spaces. This is the idea why he designed the small vehicle. And as you can see, it can move between boats, between in small spaces, and so on. Nice. Let me now conclude the presentation, the lecture of today. So today I try to present you an application which I have worked with this last year. So this application concerns the control of underwater vehicles. We have seen that the addressed problem has to deal with some challenges like the nonlinearities, the external disturbances, the variable environment, and so on. And we have proposed different control solutions. I have not detailed the solutions. I will give you a link if you want to look to the in more detail the proposed solutions. We have validated in different underwater vehicles. Some of them, they are here. And for the future work, now we are interested in underwater manipulation. So we are interested in vehicles equipped with manipulators, with robotic arms, and we control the vehicle and the arm to do manipulation. So this is the future work. And to finish, I give you, so actually, yes, the link to my webpage here. If you want to download the papers, the research papers, where you can find details of the controllers, you have ResearchGate. And also, if you want to see more videos of the experiments, you can go to this YouTube channel. You can just put the name, my name, in YouTube. You can find this YouTube channel, and you can find around between 50 and 60 videos in this showing the control of different kind of robots, so underwater vehicles and others. I can give you also here the my email address if you need anything. And I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Luis de Amezzo. Someone had a question?
Yes, please.
The maximum depth or the,
how much depth it can support?
Actually, I think it can go until 100 meters of maximum depth. The experiments that I shown, they are just few meters. So it was in a lake, and it is approximately around 2 meters of depth, just to validate the concept. But it was designed to be able to go up to 100 meters of maximum depth. Yes, exactly. It has a ballast system. We didn't use it yet, yes, but it is equipped with the ballast system. We can use it also for the control.
Because I was thinking that maybe for the depth control, it could be better if you use also the,
exactly,
the ballast.
I agree, yes.
Because it seems like on-off.
Yes, exactly. What we can try to do is to combine the two control actions. I mean, we control the fins until we arrive around the desired value. When you arrive, we can switch to the ballast control such that we can be still more stable and so on. But yes, this is true, but we have not used the ballast control system.
And also, if there are more depth, maybe the fins will not have so much power to control it?
The power is coming from the motors. Normally, we didn't try 100 meters, the mechanical design, the resistance of the materials and so on, it was done for 100 meters, maximum depth. But we didn't try yet. Yes.
Exactly. Maybe the control sends so much power, but the fins.
Exactly. And also we have the idea to do a study about the energy consumption of the fins and to compare this energy consumption with the propeller. For instance, you can do this study. Then know the justification of the fins, I have explained it. It's the disturbance of the sediments. It's better than the propellers. But for the energy, we can compare if the fins, they need more energy or less energy. This can be also a good study.
And also,
if
you want to communicate.
Ah, yes. Yes, actually, no communication is here. Actually, everything is embedded. So we upload the code, and we start the control, and there is no communication. In one of some videos, we can see cable. We have just put so the Wi-Fi antenna near to the receiver. This is why you see the cable. Otherwise, it's autonomous. And actually, we didn't try to do communication underwater, but the robot has some sonars, but some specific sonars. They have been designed in this lab. It's not the sonars from commercial sonars. They have designed specifically for UCAP. And you know why? Because they have designed this robot. It's a low-cost underwater vehicle. Why? They thought that for the archaeologists, they don't have enough money to buy very expensive robots. So the challenge, you know why? The challenge is if you have low cost, the quality is not so good of the different elements because the price is not so high, and how you can deal with all the problems, the imprecision and so on of these elements, and to control properly the vehicle. This is the challenge. Yes? Yes. The hydrophones are, the three of them are on the vehicle. Yes, I know. We can put hydrophones outside the vehicle. One here, and one on the vehicle, and you can use this for localization. No. Here, in our case, the three hydrophones on the vehicle. And from the measurement of the hydrophones, between the hydrophones and the pinger, we use these three measurements. And we try to localize the position of the pinger, and then we give this information to the controller of the yoke. He will control the yoke, and we try also to push the robot to go to the pinger. We try two techniques. The first one is we control the yoke, we move without controlling the yoke, then we control again the yoke, and so on. This is alternatively, so yoke surge. And we use another solution where we control both at the same time. So we control the yaw and we while moving. And it was better than the first one. But also one thing which is very important, in the experiment that I show, following the diver, we try to put the diver and the vehicle approximately the same height, the same depth. Otherwise, it will not work. Exactly. Thank you, Eva. Yes, please. Why it is? It can be a problem. It can be the pressure, it can be a problem, but if you design the robot that supports this pressure, there will be no problem. But in the design, yes, for sure. If you design a vehicle and you don't pay attention about this, you, for instance, you go to a high depth, you can have water that will be inside the vehicle that will damage the electronics and so on. So, but otherwise, if you design to go maximum depth, you know approximately the pressure, maximum pressure, so you can go up to this value. But it's not, because the materials of the vehicle, they support this pressure. Other questions or remarks? No questions? Thank you very much.
The Polytechnic University of Tulacinco grants the following acknowledgement to PhD Ameche Mori for her have given the lecture Adaptive Control of Small Tethered Autonomous Underwater Vehicle on the framework of the 10th International Research Congress from the Polytechnic University of Tulacinco. Tulacinco de Bravo Hidalgo, February 13, 2018, Arturo Gil Borja, Rector. Finally, PhD Amen, tomorrow he will give another lecture about dynamic walking control toward human-like walking at the same time, at the same place.
Universidad Politécnica de Tulancingo. Líderes construyendo su futuro.